This is Dr. Nandini, periodontist from the Department of Pediatric and Preventive Dentistry, Vinayaka Mission, Sankaracharya Dental College. Today, I'm going to talk about pit and fissure sealants. These are the contents. Talking about the introduction, prevalence of caries has decreased in the past two decades due to water fluoridation, dentrifices, improved oral hygiene, changes in diet, and awareness. Despite dramatic reduction in caries in fluoridated community, the disease still continues to occur during childhood, and there is a sustained caries susceptibility of pits and fissures. Pit was given by Ash in 1993. It is defined as a small pinpoint depression located at the junction of the developmental grooves or at the terminal of those grooves. Fissure definition was given by Orbans in the year 1954. He defined fissures as deep clefts between adjoining cusps. Pit and fissure sealants was given by Simonsen in the year 1978. He used the term to describe a material that is introduced into the occlusal pits and fissures of a caries susceptibility, thus forming a micromechanically bonded protective layer, cutting access of caries, producing bacteria from their source of nutrients. This is where the history. In 1867, author stated that decay is inevitable and that obliteration of fissure could prevent its occurrence. Prophylactic odontotomy term was defined by Hyatt in the year 1922. He advocated filling the fissures of teeth with silver or copper oxyphosphate cement as soon as tooth erupted, and then later they are fully into mouth, preparing a small occlusal cavity and filling it with amalgam in future days. In 1955, Bonacore observed that after treatment of enamel with acid solutions, attachment of acrylic resin to tooth surfaces was greatly increased. Bistuma was developed by Bowen in the year 1965 at National Bureau of Standard from adduct of bisphenol A and glycerin methacrylate. Bonacure in 1970 utilized Bistuma system but employed an ultraviolet sensitive polymerization initiative which allowed more flexibility in clinical application of material to the teeth. In 1971, first pit and fissure sealant NuaSeal was developed and commercially introduced. These are the types of pit and fissures. V type constitutes to 35% of the individuals. U constitutes to 14%. I type 19%. IK type 26%. Inverted Y type for 7% of the children. These are the types of pits and fissures where U type is almost the same width from top to bottom, V type wide at the top and gradually narrowing towards the bottom, I type an extremely narrow slit, then IK type with extremely narrow slit with large space at the bottom, inverted Y. These are the different fissure patterns which is viewed under longitudinal ground sections of 4x magnification. First is U type, V type, I type, and the IK type. The morphology of pit and fissure sealants. The fissure contains organic plug composed of reduced enamel epithelium, microorganism forming dental plaque, and oral debris. Increased susceptibility of this surface to caries provides a protected night for plaque accumulation. Anatomy of fissures. The fissures contain an organic plug composed of reduced enamel epithelium, microorganisms forming dental plaque and oral debris. Fissure provides a knife for plaque accumulation. Morphology of occlusal surfaces varies from one tooth to another. Premolar contains primary fissures with three or four pits. In molar, as many as 10 separate pits may be present in primary, secondary, and supplemental fissures. This is the plaque composition of pit and fissures. The fissures contain microorganisms and food particles. Limited morphological types occur in fissure. Palisading and branching filaments are absent within fissures but may colonize at the orifice. Empty ghost-like cell wall structures intermingle with viable cells in some areas. This is about the caries progression in pits and fissures. There is high risk area on the occlusal surfaces wherein 80% of the decay occurs in children's teeth. This is the deep pit where the tooth bristle is too large to remove the bacteria from these deep pits and fissures. So here is the accumulation of bacteria. This bacteria then spreads laterally, leading to caries lesions. Indications for pits and fissures: deep retentive pits and fissures, which may cause wedging of an explorer, stained pits and fissures with minimum appearance of decalcification, no radiographic or clinical evidence of proximal caries, possibility of adequate isolation, questionable enamel caries in pit and fissure, caries-free pits and fissures, caries pattern indicative of more than one lesion per year, the morphology of pit at the risk of caries exposure in the future, factors associated with increased caries incidence, routine dental care with active preventive dentistry program, community-based sealant programs. These are the contraindications. The contraindications for pit and fissure sealants are well-coalized self-cleansing pits and fissures, radiographic or clinical evidence of interproximal caries, tooth which is not fully erupted, isolation which is not possible, life expectancy of the tooth is limited, dentinal caries, lack of preventive practices. These are the AAPD recommendations for the placement of pits and fissures. The sealants should be placed into the pits and fissures of the teeth based upon the patient's caries risk and not on the patient's age or time lapsed since the tooth eruption. Sealants should be placed on the surfaces which is judged to be at high risk or surfaces that already exhibit incipient lesions to inhibit the progression of lesion. Follow-up of care as with all dental treatment is recommended. Sealant placement should include careful cleaning of pits and fissures without removal of any appreciable enamel. Some circumferences may indicate the use of a minimal enamelplasty technique. A low viscosity hydrophilic material bonding layer as a part of or under the actual sealants is recommended for long-term retention and effectiveness. GIC materials could be used as traditional sealants also. These are the EAPD guidelines. Patient and tooth selection should be based on the following. Children and young people with medical, physical or intellectual impairment. Children and young people with signs of acute caries activity. All susceptible pits and fissure sites should be considered for fissure sealants, including the buccal fissures of permanent molars. Children and young people with no signs of caries activity, only deeply fissured and thus potentially susceptible surfaces should be considered for sealing. It should be mentioned that all children, irrespective of caries activity, should be regularly monitored for any change in risk factors and/or clinical or radiographic evidence of a change in their caries status. These are the types of pit and fissure sealants according to the chemical structures of the monomers used. It is methyl methacrylate, triethyl glycol dimethacrylate, bisphenol dimethacrylate, reaction product of bisphenol A and glycidyl methacrylate, that is BisGMA, ESPE monomer, propyl methacrylate, urethane. Based on the generation, the first generation sealants are polymerized with UV light of 356 mu meter. This excessive absorption and incomplete polymerization at its depth. So came the second generation in which cell cure or chemical cure resin based on accelerated catalyst system. In third generation, it is light cured with a visible light of 430 to 490 mu meter. The fourth generation are the fluoride releasing sealants. Based on the filler content, it is classified as filled sealants and they are more resistant to wear. The unfilled sealants have got a better flow and more retention but abrade rapidly. Based on curing, it's of two types. One is autopolymerizing and the other one is cured by light. Based on color, it's clear, tinted or colored. And this is the clinical technique for the placement of PED and Fischer sealants. A simple video that explains of a flowable sealant. First, the sealant is placed into the deep occlusal surfaces. Then it is light cured. Thereby, the sealant is set. So, before starting up with the procedure, it's very essential to cleansing up the two surfaces, that is mainly the occlusal surfaces. As in all dental procedures, one must begin with appropriate cleansing of tooth. This is done using a profi cup and pumice with water. Any non-fluoride paste which is not oil-based can also be used. The explorer is run through the grooves of untrapped pumice. The clinical technique for the placement of PED and Fischer sealant, step one is isolation of tooth rubber dam or with the help of cotton rolls. The procedure of sealant placement is very technique sensitive. So moisture control is essential for optimum bone strength. In step two, it's tooth preparation where Brocklers in 1992 suggested add abrasion with aluminium oxide particles is the best method of cleaning, results in improved resin wetting, more number of resin tag formation. Garcia Gore et al. In 1994, Zervo et al. In 2000 recommends enamelplasty as it also increases the surface area and micro leakage. Step three is acid etching the tooth surface. Apply the etching agent to the tooth surface using a fine brush or a mini sponge according to manufacturer's recommendations. Bonacure initially used 80% phosphoric acid, but nowadays 37% of phosphoric acid is recommended. Rub the etching applicator over the tooth surface, including 2 to 3 mm of cuspal inclines. Etching time is very rigorous procedure. Dougal et al. In 1997 used different etching timing of 15, 30, 45, and 60 seconds and concluded that there is no difference in retention of the sealant using different etching time. Tandon et al. In 1989 have proposed an etching time of 15 seconds to be sufficient for primary teeth. Scientific basis for acid etching. This is given by Silverstone in the year 1975. Acid etching on surface enamel has shown to produce a degree of porosity. First, a zone of enamel is removed by etching. Mainly, the plaque and pellicles are dissolved. Fully reacted inert mineral crystals in the surface of the enamel are also removed, resulting in more reactive surface, increase in surface area and decrease in surface tension. The first zone is 10 mm in depth. Second zone is the qualitative porous zone, which is 20 mm in depth. Because of the porosities created, this zone may be distinguished qualitatively from enamel by polarized light microscopy. The third zone is quantitative porous zone with small porosities and is 20 mm deep. This is about the types of etching pattern. It includes three types. In type one, that is generalized roughening of enamel surface, but with a distant hollowing of prism centers and relatively intact peripheral regions. In type two, the prism peripheries appear to be damaged. The prism cores are left projecting towards the original enamel surfaces. In type three, it shows neither the type one nor the type two etching pattern, but appear as generalized surface roughening. And step four, rinse and dry the edge tooth surface. Rinse and etch the dry tooth surface with a water as spray for 30 seconds. It removes the etching agent and reaction products from the etched enamel surface. Step 5 is application of bonding agent. Application of a halogenated bonding agent after etching displaces saliva from enamel, thereby improving sealant wetting of surface and increases the bond strength. Step 6 is application of sealant. Apply the material and allow it to flow into pits and fissures. In mandibular teeth, apply the sealant distally and allow it to flow mesially with the converse for the maxillary teeth. Allow the sealant to flow in the etched pit and fissures to avoid incorporating air into the material and to avoid creating voids. Step 7 is curing of the sealant. According to the manufacturer's recommendation, Hicks et al. In 2000 found that argon laser curing of sealant material may enhance the caries resistance. Step 8, explore the sealed tooth surfaces. Explore the entire tooth surface for pits and voids that may have not been sealed. Step 9 is evaluation of occlusion. Evaluation of occlusion of sealed tooth surface with articulating paper to determine if any excessive sealant is present and needs to be removed. Step 10, recall and evaluation. Recall and check the patient at subsequent visits. It is necessary to re-evaluate the sealed tooth surface for loss of the material, exposure of voids, and caries development, especially in the first 6 months of placement. Clinical issues regarding the ped and fission sealant usage for sealant retention. Simonson, in his study, reported 15-year retention rates for single application of sealant on permanent molars. Out of this, 27.6% showed complete retention, 35% partial retention, 68.6% remained caries free. None of the teeth that either completely or partially retained sealant developed caries. Horowitz landmark Kalispell study in the year 1977. In this 5-year report of this study, the authors reported 42% complete retention at 5 years. Fluoride used with sealants. In an evaluation after 4 years of the combined use of fluoride and dental sealants, the overall proportion of sealants retained on occlusal surfaces of first molars after an average of 2 years is 92%. And this study was done by Selvitz in the year 1995. This study suggests that pit and fissure sealants confer additional caries preventive benefits beyond those of fluoride therapy alone. In a 2-year-old clinical evaluation done by Carlson in 1997 of a fluoride-containing fissure sealant, that is Helioseal F, in young school children at high risk for caries, a total of 431 fissure sealants were placed at baseline. Complete retention was found in 77% during the study period, while 22% were partially lost. 6 sealants, that is 1%, were completely lost. Hicks MJ in the year 2000 did an in vitro analysis of fluoride release by pit and fissure sealant and showed that sealant may provide additional protection against caries formation in cuspal inclined enamel and smooth surfaces adjacent to sealed pits and fissures. Sealant may act as a fluoride reservoir with long-term release of fluoride into the immediately adjacent oral environment. Glass ionomer materials as sealants. The logical assumption that a material that releases fluoride, such as glass ionomer cement, would provide an added benefit to the retentive blocking of the fissure by an resin sealant. Study by Majer and Majer in 61% of glass ionomer sealants were lost within 6 to 12 months and 84% after 30 to 60 months. The clinical evaluation of the resin-based sealants showed an average complete retention rate of 90% after 4.55 years. Seppa et al. In 1991 suggested that fissures sealed with glass ionomer are more resistant to demineralization than control fissures even after macroscopic sealant loss. This may be the result of the combined effect of fluoride released by the glass ionomer and residual material in the bottom of the fissures. Glass ionomer cements have documented high levels of fluoride release. Sealant over caries. Handelman in 1972 was the first to report on the interesting aspect of application of sealant over caries. In his two-year analysis, Handelman noted that preliminary clinical and radiographic findings suggest that there was not progression of the caries lesions. Goeing et al. Noted that a limited number of cultivatable organisms persist in some lesions, but their numbers are very few and they do not appear capable of continuing destruction of the tooth structure. Use of an intermediate bonding layer. Fiegel came up with a novel concept that hydrophilic bonding materials can be used in pedofissure sealants. Use of bonding agent under sealant on wet contamination yielded bonding agents equivalent to the bond strength obtained when sealant was bonded directly to clean etched enamel. For the newer development and projections with the use of sealants, shorter etching times as short as 15 seconds have been found to be just effective, and that is as effective as the longer times of etching seconds. Sol et al. Also looked at cleaning methods and found that use of a sodium bicarbonate air polishing system resulted in a statistically significant higher retention of sealant. Irinoda et al. Showed that a low viscosity sealant penetrates better and forms a resin impregnated layer with enamel, whereas the higher viscosity sealants tested did not penetrate through enough into the deep pits and fissures to ensure that the acid etched enamel was infiltrated sufficiently by the sealant to ensure good marginal seal. Use of lasers with sealants. In 1993 study, Hicks and co-workers found that argon laser curing of sealant material may enhance the caries resistance of the enamel forming the enamel resin interface and result in reduction in caries formation adjacent to the sealants placed. This is for the cost effectiveness with the use of sealants. At the 10-year point of a 15-year study, it was found that it is 1.6 times as costly to restore the caries lesions in the first permanent molars in an unsealed group of 5 to 10-year-old children living in a fluoridated area than it is to prevent with a single application of Pitt-Fisher sealants. The greater number of caries lesions was observed if Pitt-Fisher sealants is not utilized. This study was reported by Simonson in the year 1982. So the sealants are found to be very cost effective in comparing with the benefits of its effect. It has been documented for decades that sealants are safe, effective, and underused. The latest data available indicates that in United States, only 15% of children with the ages of 6 to 19 have dental sealants. This study was done by Cherry Peppers G in the year 1995. So the sealants were always oversold and underused. So the last conclusion part, Pitt and Fisher sealant can be regarded as cost-effective preventive measure. Effectiveness of sealants are increased with proper isolation techniques and appropriate follow-up and releasing whenever necessary. Thus, from the concepts of prevention like drill and fill, it's better to go for a process of seal and heal. Thank you for attention.